Hey guys, Kyle Bascom here. I am the Mercedes Catalog Manager, and today we're going to be discussing the Mercedes W212 suspension. We've got an E350 behind us today. Got a bunch of components that make up the front and rear suspension of this vehicle, and we'll be talking about the suspension layout, going over some diagnosis of suspension failures, and just what to look out for on the platform. When I say W212, I'm referring to the Mercedes E-Class models that were produced between 2010 and 2016 that were available either all-wheel drive or rear-wheel drive. W212 is also specific to E-Class sedans and wagons. The coupes and convertibles are slightly different, and we won't be touching that today. Just a reminder, guys, everything that we're going to talk about and cover today is also available on our W212 Mercedes Hub. Additionally, it is November, and we are running our biggest sale of the year, which is Cyber Month. So be sure to check the website for all of the deals that are available for your W212. Additionally, if you're watching this and it's after our Cyber Month sale, be sure to go to coupons.fcpeuro.com. I'm sure we have a deal for you there. So, just a quick overview of the Mercedes W212 suspension setup. The 212 is a bit of a departure from previous E-Class models. So, the 211 had a double wishbone front suspension. The 212 has a McPherson setup. So, you have a strut that's connected to the spindle, and then you have two lower arms. This setup is very similar to the W204, so if you've seen any of my W204 videos in the past, what we're going to be discussing on the 212 today and the failure points are actually quite similar. In the rear of the W212, you have a new version or an updated version of the 5-link rear suspension that you guys are probably all familiar with, something that Mercedes started doing way back in about 1986 that they still do today. Because we've got a wagon behind us, we're going to get a chance to look at air suspension as well. Not that common of a feature on the W212 models, but if you had an 8-cylinder car, like an E550, one of the early, like the pre-facelift ones, you likely have air suspension. And if you have a wagon, you've got air suspension in the rear. Much later in the cycle for E550s and other models, they actually phased out the air. And if you have an AMG model, you have rear self-leveling, but you've got a more traditional steel suspension up front. In terms of common issues, if you've got clunks when turning, one of the most common wear items on this front suspension is going to be your front end links. I'll show you how to inspect that on the vehicle. Additionally, just like every other McPherson setup, the tension strut bushing is a very common failure point. In terms of how frequently you'll be replacing components, at around 70,000 miles, it's a good idea to consider replacing all of your front suspension components. So what do I mean by that? Your front struts, your upper strut mounts, your end links, your control arms. And then when we're talking about a change interval for the rear suspension, right around 110,000, 120,000 miles, everything's probably gonna be shot back there, and you should consider replacing the majority of those arms as well. Well, now that we've gone through an overview of the suspension, let's take a walk over to this E350 that we have behind us, and I'll show you how to inspect all of the suspension links. All right, so what makes up your basic W212 suspension? It's a McPherson setup, like I mentioned earlier in the video. We've got a strut up there, control arm here, we'll call it a tension strut, and we've got one additional arm here. And then lastly, your sway bar end link. In terms of noises, cracking, popping, things of that nature, especially during tight turns or parking lot maneuvers, your sway bar end link is normally going to be the source of that noise. In this case, what you can see here is this one's pretty blown out, so I've got the grease from inside the boot on my glove. If you see the grease outside of the end link, replace it, replace end links in pairs. So look for this guy first. Next thing you want to look out for is this tension strut that I mentioned. In order to determine if it's starting to wear, look out for cracking along the edge of the bushing. You can come in with a pry bar and just move it back and forth like this. What that helps you do is to expand the cracks in the rubber so you can see if it is perished. Also visually, you're gonna look at this edge of the bushing for staining. That'll let you know that the hydro bushing is popped. And then lastly, you have this control arm here. you're gonna use the same type of maneuver to look at the condition of the bushing. Additionally, if you have a rear-wheel drive model, there are going to be some small differences. At the knuckle over here, you're going to have a ball joint instead of the ball joint being integral to the control arm, and the ball joint's going to go into this guy, and you're going to have a bushing at the end. Same basic principle at the end of the day, regardless of rear-wheel drive or all-wheel drive vehicle. Lastly, I want to talk about the shock absorber. So if you are driving very harsh over bumps, you hit a bump and the vehicle's kind of self-steering as well, the strut is probably blown out. When you replace the strut, you're also going to want to replace the upper strut mount. You've got rubber in this mount, and you have a bearing that allows the strut to swivel as well. So you want to replace your upper strut mount. The ones we sell are inclusive of the bearing whenever you replace your strut assembly. Now that we've taken a look at the front suspension, it's also going to be a good idea while you're in this area just to very quickly take a look at everything else in this area. Take a look at your axle boot, make sure that that's not torn. We'll cover some of these topics in more depth in future videos. In this case, what we've also observed is the vehicle was serviced in the past, the front brakes were done, the brake hose is routed incorrectly, so the caliper was turned over once more than it should have been, and this is actually looped incorrectly. So once we're done filming today, we'll pull it off and get that set up correctly. But these are things that you want to look out for while you're inspecting your front suspension. Now that we've looked at the front suspension, we're going to go to the back of the vehicle. I will show you the Mercedes rear five-link setup. All right, so we are now at the rear of the vehicle. What is this five-link that I keep referring to? Literally, there are five links that comprise the suspension. So you have your lower links, your upper links, and your spring control arm. First guy you want to look at is your tow control link. That's this guy right here. Similar to what we did at the front of the vehicle, just a light pry and inspection to see if the bushing's cracking. When you pry it, it should move a little bit, but if you see heavy cracking or if it's fully separated, this guy's gonna need to be replaced. In general, if you're noticing one suspension arm needs replacement, seriously consider replacing all of the links in the suspension, especially if you're dealing with a higher mileage vehicle. This particular one has 133,000 miles on it. There's no reason why you shouldn't replace all of the links. Looking up top, it's not very easy to see, so you're probably gonna wanna take a wheel off if you're doing the inspection, but the links up top are your camber arms. So you've got the camber arms up top, your tow control link, and your spring control arm. For this particular vehicle, at the spring control arm, you're going to have an air spring. Because it has the rubber bellows on the exterior, you're not really going to be able to determine if it has blown out. However, if you're noticing after a day or two the vehicle's sitting overnight, it's starting to sag, you're going to want to replace the air spring. Similar to the suspension links, replace both of them. Last thing you want to take a look at is the shock absorber. What we noticed on this car is the shock body on this side's dry. I'll show you what it looks like on the other side. There's a lot of misting. Misting is not necessarily an indication that the shock is blown out. Just with the piston stroking the way it normally does, sometimes you have the misting, and that oil mist will attract dust. So it's going to be a combination of a visual inspection and how does the car feel while you're driving. If it doesn't feel well damped in the rear, it's bouncing really hard, replace both shock absorbers also. So another thing to be aware of if you're trying to diagnose suspension issues, specifically with the air suspension, if you notice that the vehicle's not sitting at the correct height, or if it's sitting too high, when you're inspecting the upper camber arms, there is a height level sensor that's attached to it. Sometimes that linkage can break if you hit a pothole or something like that. It may pop out of the socket, and then the air suspension system won't know the correct height of the rear axle. So this is definitely something you want to check out while you're back there. All right, guys, so we've checked out the front and rear suspension on the W212. Hope you found the information that you saw here today very helpful. Quick tip for you, if you are changing your oil or transmission fluid and you're under the vehicle, that is the perfect time to check your suspension components, make sure everything's still up to snuff. In terms of change intervals, remember at around 70,000 miles, everything in your front suspension is probably going to need to be replaced. At around 110 to 120, take a look at that rear suspension. And if you have any questions at all, be sure to leave them in the comments, like, and subscribe. Thanks for watching.